What went wrong here? What turned House of Fraser from being a legend of retailing to being just another tale of a shop that shut down in the 21st century? Bad management, really. This is retail news, but less stuffy. I am wearing my suit, look. I am wearing my suit and my tie, but it's just too rainy. I'm going to be talking about House of Fraser again. And they can't even fill the store anymore because they've got so little stock. Now, when Mike Ashley first took over House of Fraser, I was quite positive about it. It's got a lot of brands. It could have made a lot of change. It could have really turned House of Fraser into the Harrods of the High Street as you wanted to. Department stores back in the day used to do everything. You could get your hair done there, you could have your beauty treatments done there. You could have anything you wanted to do, you went to a department store. And do you know what? Department stores, no matter what decade you're in, have always struggled against competition. Well, that's fortuitous. A Harrods van. Of course, Harrods was a part of House of Fraser for a very long time. Now, one word which I'd completely forgotten about, which that book reminded me of, was stores that are called multiples. And that would be Marks and Spencers and Next, them sort of shops. They were competition way before the internet. And you had the war, you know, clothes rationing. Debenhams as well, and House of Fraser, they managed to survive through all of that. So why is House of Fraser struggling now? When Mike Ashley first took over, like just a minute ago, I was quite positive about it. He saved it from administration. He wanted Debenhams, but is this history repeating itself again? You know when Philip Green, he wanted to buy Marks and Spencer, and he got all huffed, didn't he? Because he didn't get it, so he bought BHS instead, British Home Stores. He was going to turn it into the big rival to Marks and Spencer's, but in the end just shoved it full of his own brands and sort of gave up because Topshop took his eye off the ball and he decided to push his Topshop and Topman brands instead, leaving BHS to be full of Arcadia stuff that he sold it off for a pound and it went bust. Anyway, we've been there, done that, we know the story. Is Mike Ashley doing the same with House of Fraser? He got it, now he regrets buying it. In his own words, or the company's own words, of Sports Direct, obviously. But there's no need. It's got loads of potential. And he's just leaving it to rack and ruin. I gave him a bit of leeway when he first took it over because people said he's just filled it with Sports Direct stuff. At the beginning, that wasn't his fault. The previous ownership had given it no stock for autumn-winter 2018. It's now autumn-winter 2019. And the store is looking worse than it did then. Now, any support that I had for Mike Ashley owning House of Fraser has evaporated. The roof is off, the water's pouring into House of Fraser, and is anyone going to stop it? They've recently denied that they're going to close a load of stores anyway, because now Mike Ashley is trying to push his Fraser brand, isn't he? He's opening one store up in a former Debenhams department store.
I don't even bother turning the TVs on or anything anymore. There used to be a security guard down here, you know, making sure no one was nicking anything, but as usual, there's not here. They can't even fill this store anymore in Westfield. This down here used to be full of all sorts. Oh, they just fill it with suitcases at 50% off. Seems to be permanent. Do I dare get this lift? I want to get the lift.
Door opening.
Sorry, clearly some of the lights are not working. Oh, God.
Doors closing.
Window displays used to be a massive thing in department stores. As Claire Timpkin said in the film Mannequin, if the window displays are good, if people stop to look, they'll stay to buy. That didn't happen in a department store.
Down there, beauty and beverage. Doors opening.
Oh, God.
tools than ever, man.
So there is still some nice stuff in your book. Yeah, there is still some nice stuff here, but they've had to bulk it out across the shelves to fill the shop up. Look at the state of this! And they say everything's fine at House of Fraser. This is meant to be a department store that's open. It's Echo! There are always flowers to where everyone wants to see them. That's quite sad.
This is of no disrespect to the current staff who work in the stores, by the way. They do a really good job trying to keep it clean and tidy and give good customer service. I have shopped quite a few times in House of Fraser, but there's even less of a reason now. This is Saturday morning, by the way. I would have expected it to have been a tad busier than this. Everything's just a little bit tacky. Now, things just seem to be shoved on rails. I'm going up to the menswear section. This is a section I don't normally come up to very often in House of Fraser anymore. Because if I'm going to pay, which I don't, but if I was to pay a lot of money for clothes, I'm not going to buy them from here. I bumped into a member of staff, and I don't know if she was surprised because I know they bumped into it, or the fact that there was a customer in here at all. And they was going to get rid of the brand Bieber, and I've just heard on one of the recorded announcements that it's returned to House of Fraser. It's too little too late, actually. But oh, it's really sad. Things are not quite right. There's quite a lot of salad taped up, broken things, and that sort of thing going on. The where they put the till areas, they've all bashed up. Everything just seems a bit tired. And as it reaches the point now where House of Fraser is never going to be the same as it was, it's really frustrating because House of Fraser are Hammonds of Hull, as it used to be. And oh, what was the other one? Bins, back in the day, HB Bins. And then there was another, well, that's how House of Fraser built up. It was by purchasing standalone department stores. And it worked very well for a very long time, up until the last 20 minutes. Well, 20 years, I should say. Yeah. Oh, going for the perfume bit, my nose is itching. That's all the old Chanel counter bit. All closed down now. I've just currently left House of Fraser because I believe the security guard was beginning to get a little bit, seen behind me. He was getting a little bit worried. Well, they've got nothing else to do, bless them, have they? I am an actual House of Fraser customer still. I don't shop there as much as I wanted to, but I still am, so by all means, if he was going to throw me out, that would have been the death knell for me, because there is plenty of other places to shop. It just really frustrates me, because it's got so much potential. It really has, and they're just leaving that Westfield store, like that. All that open space that's unused because they can't fill it anymore, and all them closed down Chanel stands and whatnot. That is completely unacceptable for any store to do that, to have something like that. Anyway, I can imagine the security guard actually buzzing through to the general House of Fraser staff, the general Westfield security, so I'm expecting to be stopped filming in a minute. But, oh, why? Why? Mike Ashley had all the opportunity to return House of Fraser to its current status. Alright, there might still have been a few closed down stands, but he owns Evan Cycles. He could have brought the bike section back. In there, it'd have been brilliant. I'd have bought a bike from there. I hate getting the bus. And what else could he have stuffed in there that he owns? He owns the Flannels brand. Why didn't he shove that in there? Just to keep customers coming in. They should have put a cafe in there, all that open space. Why is there not a cafe in there? But then with them sort of views, that'd be a lovely thing, especially on a rainy day like this, and you know how much I love the rainy weather. All that space, just wasted. And then they have the audacity to blame things like Brexit and blame things like the tough retail climate. Well, of course it's a tough retail climate if you've got a whole shop with nothing to sell. Oh. What else did I learn in that book? This bit's really interesting in the book because it says during the 70s and 80s, obviously the recessions, what they had. Whitelist, Swan and Edgar and Thorns all closed big department stores. Debenhams, with stores throughout the country, traded down and made a blaze of banners and bonanzas. That rings a bell, that could be like just recently, couldn't it? In the prevailing conditions, high volume discount stores like Asda, Comet, which used to be an electrical store, and MFI, which used to sell furniture, appeared to be gaining ground rapidly at the expense of department stores. You see, competition for department stores every single decade. There's no excuse for them now to be struggling the way they are. They should be finding a way out of it. If they could retail a way out of a recession in the 70s and 80s, they should definitely be doing it in the 2000s and the 2010s. You may recognise this really old picture. This is actually the House of Fraser in Oxford Street now, used to be D.H. Evans. And it's a store that in the early 1980s, along with a store in Birmingham, they sold the stores to lease it back, just two of them, which is something they did to all stores in the very late 2010s, which is just history repeating itself over and over again. Obviously, by selling all the stores and leasing them back, makes a quick buck for the department store owners and shareholders and whatnot, but it does make a long-term problem of, well, if sales don't go so well, what's it going to do? And that's the problem my Cashley's got now, is that they've got these massive stores now with massive leases, which they didn't have before because they used to own them outright. Stores like this massive, what used to be Army and Navy store, and they now have to pay rent on that. My grandma and my mum used to call it bins still, because that's what a lot of the stores were branded as. And in another twist of cycles of things coming back round, House of Fraser launched a lifestyle section. And obviously that would have been a much better quality than what it is now, because Sports Direct stuff is probably nowhere near the same tier of this. You may have seen when I went into House of Fraser to have that look around, they're actually selling trainers for 20 quid, which is not a Harrods thing. House of Fraser thing. Look at that, look how it's merchandised. That's how they merchandise the lifestyle section. Oh look, there's the old store. That's closed down now, I just closed it recently. Look how it's merchandised. It's just House of Fraser, as you just saw, is not merchandised like this at all anymore, is it? Another bit that encapsulates the sign of the time, the store is king. And it says here, look, bins and so many more, I mean, it was all under the House of Fraser brand. To encapsulate the vision of the group, had coined the watchword of the 90s, which Lord Fraser and his passionate belief of the supremacy of the department store would wholeheartedly have supported, the store is king. Well, not anymore. And that's where the book abruptly ends, in the 1990s, very early 1990s, which is such a shame, because I really wish this book had just gone on just 10 years longer. And because that was when department stores were still struggling. But it was just before the internet really wanted 2000. I wish this book just had 10 more years left to explain why House of Fraser and Debenhams was so relevant and needed. And even now, oh, they could still be brilliant. But they're not. Look at this. This is from the section saying retailing out of the recession. House of Fraser had weathered the most turbulent decade in its history, exposed not only to the harsh climate of the recession, but when the upturn came to a gale of criticisms of its plans and policies from Lonra, this was a major shareholder who was very vocal during the decade. With steely courage, Professor Smith had resisted Tana Rowland's relentless attrition, I turned it into advantage in shaping future strategy. With his marketing expertise, he was able to give definition to the latent talents of House of Fraser. Bill Crossan and the other executive directors responded by building on the foundations laid by Sir Hugh Fraser since 1966 to regenerate the group into the 80s. Lifestyle and the massive refurbishment programme are poised to transform House of Fraser, which would continue to combine the quality of tradition with the best of modern merchandising. Hedged about with difficulties, House of Fraser had deployed all its skill to retail out of the recession. In the northeast, it was Bins Limited that was owned eventually by House of Fraser. It actually predates House of Fraser, like 1781, so it's one of the oldest department store chains, again, like Debenhams. One of the other problems previous management did of House of Fraser was open up blatantly silly stores in unprofitable places. They should have just kept it as it was. So stores like this at Westfield, which opened up as an House of Fraser, I don't think it was a good idea. They needed to just keep the stores they already had and update them a little bit. And just update what they sold. Because all I know they're selling House of Fraser is clothes and homeware and perfume. Three things. And that's not what department stores used to be. A department store was a department store. You went into a department store to get everything. What's happened is Debenhams and House of Fraser have actually turned into multiples. They've turned into what they would have considered competition 40 years ago. And that concludes today's video. It's a real shame that House of Fraser might not even see the next decade. And I feel really sorry for the current staff that work there on the shop floor. Because if you lose your job because your store closes down, it's not because of the tough retail, economic climate, Brexit, whatever excuse they'll give. It's because now, just like the last couple of previous managements, they've just run House of Fraser into the ground with poor products choosing, choice, merchandising. It's just really annoying. This is a company that has managed to get through world wars. It's managed to get through recessions. It's managed to get through several of its stores burning to the ground, and it still survived. Yet what killed House of Fraser off was bad CEOs, bad ownership, selling off and leasing back stores. No investment since the 1990s. And the same goes for Debenhams. Anyway, thanks. Oh, before I do finish that off, Debenhams has just recently crowed about how chuffed it is. It's been given £50 million to get through its Christmas trading. Have you ever read anything in your life? A shop, a company needing money to get through the tough Christmas season. That's the season you're supposed to be making money, not spending it. You see what I mean? Anyway, thanks for watching. Scrass Bellamy. Do you agree or disagree to this video? Thanks, Scrass Bellamy. See you when I see you. Bye.